Good morning. Today we will cover the topic anchorage in orthodontics. Introduction. The force used to move teeth in orthodontic therapy is derived from some anatomical areas which act as anchors. So anchors are basically anything, a tooth, a group of teeth, a muscle or an anatomical structure which we use to move another tooth or a group of teeth. The resistance that the anchorage area offers to unwanted tooth movements is called anchorage. So what is the definition? Graber has defined anchorage in orthodontics as the nature and degree of resistance to displacement offered by an anatomic unit for the purpose of affecting tooth movement. According to Voigt and Gardiner, anchorage is the site of delivery from which a force is exerted. Anchorage during orthodontic therapy is obtained from two sources. Basically, intraoral sources and extraoral sources. So, what are the intraoral sources? Here, the points marked A, B, C, and D are the intraoral sources. A is a tooth, B is the alveolar bone, C is the basal bone, and D is the muscle. And extraoral sources are marked by E, F, G, and H, that is the occipital bone, the parietal bone, the frontal bone, the chin, and the back of the neck. Intraoral sources of anchorage. What are intraoral sources? They are the teeth, the alveolar bone, the basal bone, and the musculature. So, coming to the teeth, whenever some teeth are moved orthodontically, the remaining teeth can act as anchorage or resistance units. The anchorage potential of teeth depends on a number of factors such as root surface area, root form, size and number of roots, root length, tooth inclination, and ankylosed teeth. Root surface area. So the anchorage depends on the size of the teeth, that is the root surface area of the teeth. The more the tooth surface area, the better will be the anchorage. So in this diagram, the root surface area of the different teeth are shown. The anteriors have with single rooted tooth will have lesser root surface area. That is the central incisor in the lower has only 170 millimeter square of root surface area. So the incisors, basically the root surface area differs from 170 to 230 millimeter square. For the canines, it is 270 to 280 millimeter square. For the premolars, 240 to 260 millimeter square. And for the molars, because they are multi-rooted, they have the maximum root surface area, and mostly that is the reason why they are used as anchorage. So the root surface area differs from 450 to 535 millimeter square, and the maximum root surface area is seen in the maxillary first molars. So more the root surface area, better will be the anchorage. Root form. So when you take a cross section of the roots, there we can see are in three different forms. One, they will see as round roots, flat roots, or triangular roots. So round roots are basically seen in bicuspids and the palatal root of maxillary molar, and they can resist horizontally directed forces in any direction. Whereas flat roots, they are seen in mandibular incisors and molars and the buccal roots of maxillary molar, and they can resist movement in the mesiodistal direction. Whereas the triangular roots, they are seen in canine and maxillary central lateral incisor, and they offer the maximum resistance to displacement compared to the round or the flat root form. So these are the cross sections that you see here, round, flat, and triangle. Based on the size and number of root, so more the number of roots, that is multi-rooted tooth, as we explained before, there will be more large of root surface area, and it will have the greater ability to withstand stress and resistance. Root length, the longer the root, the deeper it will be embedded into the bone and greater will be the resistance. Inclination of the tooth, the greater the resistance to displacement is offered when the force exerted to move the teeth is opposite to that of their axial inclination. Ankylosed teeth, orthodontic movement of such teeth is not possible and they can therefore serve as excellent anchors whenever possible. Then is the alveolar bone. Alveolar bone can resist tooth movement up to a certain amount of force, but after a certain limit, it perpetuates tooth movement because there will be bone remodeling that will be happening. Next is the basal bone. Basal bone example are the areas like the hard palate and the lingual surface of mandible. So this you can see in cases of NANS button, removable appliances, and for functional appliances, we see that the mucosa and the lingual surface of the mandible and the maxilla are used. Next is muscular anchorage. So muscular anchorage is basically when there are hypertonic muscles, like the case of a hypertonic labial muscle, we can use the lip bumper to use that force as anchorage to distalize the mandibular molars. External sources of anchorage, they are the cranium, the back of the neck, and the facial bone. So cranium, basically the occipital and the parietal anchorage, that is how we use the headgear to restrict the maxillary growth, and the back of the neck, as in how we use in for the cervical headgear. Then the facial bones, that is the frontal bone or the chin or the mandibular symphysis, which we use in the case of face mask to protect the maxilla. Example of extraoral anchorage is an occipital headgear which takes anchorage from the cranium, and a face mask which we use for the protraction of the maxilla. It takes anchorage from the frontal bone and the chin. Now, what is the classification of anchorage? It was given by Moyers. It can be divided according to the manner of force application. It can be simple anchorage, stationary anchorage, and reciprocal anchorage. According to the jaws involved, it can be intramaxillary anchorage and intermaxillary anchorage. According to the site of anchorage, it can be intraoral, extraoral, and muscular. And extraoral are the cervical, occipital, cranial, and the facial. According to the number of anchorage units, it can be single or primary anchorage, compound anchorage, and multiple or reinforced anchorage. Types of anchorage. According to the manner of force application, the first one is simple anchorage. So simple anchorage is obtained by engaging a greater number of teeth than are to be moved in the same dental arch. That is, you are trying to move a single tooth by using a number of teeth there. So it's a simple type of anchorage. The combined root surface area of the anchorage unit should be double that of the teeth to be moved. See, in this case, you can see this is an example of the simple anchorage. We are just using a simple screw to buccally move the palatally placed teeth. The rest of the whole teeth in the arch, they act as anchorage. We are using clasp for retention, and the whole base plate is taking anchorage from the rest of the teeth. Similarly, in the case of an iset spring here, we are using it for the labial movement of an incisor. Next is the stationary anchorage. When the application of force tends to displace the anchorage unit bodily in the plane of space in which the force is being applied. So the example here is the retraction of the anterior teeth. So when in fixed appliance therapy, when we are using, we use the buccal teeth as the, and here even the second premolar is taken as the anchorage. So here, only the bodily movement of the anchorage teeth is allowed, and there is no tipping. So this is staying as stationary. Even if at all it is moving, it should only move bodily. There shouldn't be tipping of the anchor teeth. Next is the reciprocal anchorage. So when two teeth or two groups of teeth of equal anchorage value are made to move in the opposite direction. So here, the two teeth which are to be moved, they should move in the opposite direction. So equal forces are acting here. So here the first example is the finger spring. So the first left lateral incisor and the right lateral incisor both have to be moved to each other to close the diastema. Similarly, here we can use elastics to close the midline diastema. Also in a posterior crossbite case, we can use the elastic to correct the single tooth crossbite. Another example is the coffin spring, which is incorporated into the base plate. Here we can use it to push both the arches to open up in case of constricted arches. Now, according to the site of anchorage, again, as we have discussed before, it is intraoral anchorage, extraoral anchorage, and muscular anchorage. So, intraoral anchorage is where all the anchorage resistance units are situated within the oral cavity. The teeth to be moved and the anatomical area that offer the anchorage are all within the oral cavity. Example, the teeth, the palate, the lingual alveolar bone of the mandible. Extraoral anchorage is anchorage in which the resistance units are situated outside the oral cavity. So we are taking anchorage from outside the oral cavity. Example, cervical area, the occipital bone, cranial bone, and the facial bone. Next is the muscular anchorage. As we discussed earlier, we are taking it from the hypertonic muscles, for example, the lip. So the example is a lip bumper which we use to distalize the molars. So this is the example where we use occipital headgear, a face mask and a chin cup for anchorage, and the lip bumper is used to take the muscular anchorage. Now, according to jaws involved, so based on which jaw we are using, it is divided into intramaxillary anchorage and intermaxillary anchorage. So intramaxillary anchorage is where the units offering the resistance, that is the anchorage unit, they are situated in the same jaw or the same arch. These are called as intramaxillary anchorage. So example as this ones we saw before, the where we incorporate the screw, the springs or the coughing spring, we are using it only in the one arch. Next is the intermaxillary anchorage. So the anchorage in which the resistant unit is situated in one jaw, but the teeth to which we are moving is in the opposite jaw. It is also termed as Baker's anchorage. So here example is class 2 and class 3 elastics, where we, that is, we are taking anchor unit from one arch, but we are trying to move the teeth in the opposite arch. So this is class 2 elastics and this is class 3 elastics. Now according to the number of anchorage units, so we can take single or primary anchorage, compound anchorage or reinforced or multiple anchorage. So single anchorages, we are only taking a single tooth as an anchorage. Compound anchorages, more than one tooth with greater support is used to move the teeth with lesser support. Reinforced or multiple anchorages, we are using more than one type of resistant unit to use as anchorage. So how can we reinforce anchorage? What are the multiple methods? So we can use extraoral forces to augment anchorage, like as we discussed in headgears and face mask, we can use extraoral anchorage or upper anterior inclined plane. This is an upper anterior inclined plane and this is a swid appliance. It is the same as the upper anterior inclined plane but with the incisal capping when it comes, it is called as a swid appliance. Next is the use of transpalatal arch or lingual arches. This is the most commonly used multiple ring anchorage example. Here we are using the molars as the anchorage, but to reinforce the anchorage so that the molars doesn't move into the extraction space, we use the transpalatal arch or the lingual. Procedure of placement and removal of the implant. Now before placing an implant, you should take a radiograph of the site where you are placing the implant. You can take an IOPR and an OPG to know the interradicular bone. The interradicular bone should be a minimum of 2 mm, which is an ideal amount for the placement of an implant. Then you should give an topical local anesthesia on the region. If you are using a self-tapping implant, then you have to drill it with a twist drill at 600 RPMs and you should cool it with sufficient saline or a coolant. As you are placing it, if the patient is uncomfortable or talks about pain, then you should remove it and reinsert it, or you should find a new position. When we use the implant driver to insert the TAD, after the TAD is placed, we use a radiograph to see the correct positioning of the TAD. The picture here shows the implant driver that we use, and we can use the same implant driver to remove the TAD under topical LA gel. Now when you place it, there will be few complications. So what are the complications that can happen in the placement of a TAD? The first is that contact with the adjacent root. This is very common if you don't place it carefully. So close contact with the PDL, that is a periodontal ligament, can cause pain and discomfort to the patient. So you can verify it with the radiograph and then reposition it. Breakage of an implant. It is very rare, but if there is too much resistance when you are placing it, you should remove and reposition it. But if it is broken, then remove it. Damage to the anatomical structures. So the maxillary sinus may be approximated when placing it in the upper premolars and molars. Also, it can cause damage to the nerve. Soft tissue overgrowth. Over the head of the implant, there are chances that the soft tissue grows. It can cause irritation to the tissues, and it is difficult to place an attachment or a ligature over the head of this implant if there is a soft tissue overgrowth. So you should try and place it on the attached gingiva, where the soft tissue overgrowth is, chances are less. Implant loosening is another complication. Because of poor bone quality or excessive force application, or if it is approximated to the root surface, then there are chances that the implant may be loosened. So it can be tightened, but if it happens again, remove and reposition it in a new place. Now, anchorage planning, this is very important in orthodontic treatment. So before starting the treatment, you should always evaluate the anchorage demands and then plan well. So what are the factors affecting? The number of teeth being moved. If there are more number of teeth that is being moved, then the demand on the anchorage is more. On the type of teeth, to move the anterior teeth, there is less strain on the anchorage. Type of movement, bodily movement means it needs more anchorage and there will be more strain on the anchorage unit. Duration, if there is a longer duration of treatment, then the strain on the anchorage unit is more. Skeletal growth pattern. In vertical growth pattern or high angle cases, there is more tendency for anchorage loss. So what is anchorage loss? It is the unwanted movement of the anchor teeth, which we don't want. But in horizontal growth pattern, because of stronger facial musculature, the chances of anchorage loss is less. Occlusal interlock. If there is a good buccal occlusion, it resists the anchorage to move. So good buccal occlusion helps in good anchorage planning. Now what is the classification of anchorage demand? This is in extraction cases. It is divided into minimum anchorage, moderate anchorage, maximum anchorage and absolute anchorage. So in cases, like in minimum anchorage cases, if this is the extraction space, then more than half of the extraction space can be lost by the anterior teeth moving mesially. This is a moderate anchorage case. The anchor teeth can be permitted to move forward into half to one-fourth of the extraction space. Means the anchor teeth can move half of the extraction space and the anterior teeth can move half of the extraction space distally. And in maximum anchorage case, not more than one-fourth of the extraction space should be lost forward. That means the anchor teeth can move only up to one-fourth of the extraction space. The rest of the extraction space should be closed by the retraction of the anterior teeth. This in severe proclination cases, it is very important. Otherwise, the retraction will not be complete. The teeth will still look proclined. Absolute anchorage is when we use a TAD. The entire extraction space is used for retraction of the anteriors. Because we are not using the posteriors for retraction, there is no chance that the forward movement of the posterior teeth will happen and the entire extraction space can be closed using the anteriors. Thank you.